Well, thank you for inviting me, and thanks for coming here at a lunchtime. I'm glad to be talking about a topic that I find really quite interesting, and hopefully I can make it interesting for you guys. If you want a handout, you can go to the website there. It's therapeuticseducation.org/handouts. Make sure you type it right, because some people go to a site called Therapeutic Seduction, and that gets you different information. So I think anyone who gives a talk should give their conflicts of interest. So my entire salary comes through the UBC Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences. I also do some legal and educational work. I've received no honorarium or research money from the drug industry in the last 30 or so years. I do a premium podcast that I'll let you know a little bit about in just a second, and we have a subscription model for that, so we make some money off of that. And I often give talks on nutrition, so I like to let people know that I'm a pescatarian for animal rights reasons, not health reasons. So, just a little bit about me. A couple of things that I do. I do a weekly podcast, and some of the content that I'm going to be presenting today is we've done a lot of this on a podcast, and we've been doing, it's called the BS Medicine Podcast, and when we put it together, we had no idea that the abbreviation would work so well. It's BS without the BS, and so we try to do this, and I do it with a good friend and colleague of mine, Mike Allen. He's a family doc, and we've been doing it over 10 years now, and it's been just a ton of fun and a great way to disseminate information, kind of like disseminating this over the internet as well. And then one of the things I try to do is make it marginally entertaining, because you can imagine talking about clinical practice guidelines could be painfully dull. And so any talk I give, I like to talk, make it somewhat entertaining, because I love this quote, anyone who tries to make a distinction between education and entertainment doesn't know the first thing about either, and it's legitimate. And for the younger people in the audience, those things in the background, those are phones, just in case you didn't know what those were. And then one other thing I get a kick out of doing is creating educational video music parodies, and you can go see those on my YouTube channel, and we've had over 1 million views of them, which is kind of fun. And there's even one on guidelines, and I'll show a clip at the end. And we cover a lot of topics, choosing wisely, polypharmacy, anti-aging cream. My sister asked me to do that one. So my real biases are, I think facts need to stand out above beliefs. You can have beliefs that are informed by facts, but really one of the things that I've done my entire career is I really want to let everybody know as best I can about the best available evidence. Sometimes it's not very good, but we need to know what the best available evidence is. Then we have the concept of guidelines, and I think there's something soothing sometimes about being able to follow guidelines, and you'll see lots of images to suggest that just follow the guidelines, it's okay. And we also, as many of you know, at the university, many of our exams are around guidelines, and so are our licensing exams around guidelines. And what I want to do is talk about how that may or may not be a problem, depending on what guidelines are like. I am not here to suggest that all guidelines are bad or they're all good. There's a good and bad to all of them. And I wanted to let you know that if you don't understand about guidelines, at least pirates do. So pirates actually know where guidelines fit, and I'll just play a clip for you.
And secondly, you must be a pirate for the pirate's code to apply, and you're not. And thirdly, the code is more what you call guidelines than actual rules. Welcome aboard the Black Pearl, Miss Turner.
So even he knows that guidelines are not rules. So it's important to put that into context. So my agenda for the talk is I'm going to describe some of the issues and problems of of clinical practice guidelines, primarily around chronic disease state guidelines, specifically look at the evidence around how evidence-based are they, who writes or sponsors them, how well do they incorporate values and preferences. I'm going to talk about a thing called a magnitudinous problem. I'm going to talk about some of the legal aspects of guidelines, suggest some ideas for going forward, show examples of some well-done guidelines. And I'd like to hear from you at the end. So what is a clinical practice guideline? Well, the definition from the Institute of Medicine is that it's a statement that includes recommendations that are informed by a systematic review of evidence with an assessment of the benefits and harms. And truly, if that is exactly what they were, they would be exceedingly useful. There are lots of guidelines. The National Guideline Clearing House, which used to house all of these, is now defunct, I think. It lost funding in 2018. The last time the National Guideline Clearinghouse looked at them, it was upwards of 10,000. That is impossible for healthcare providers to read. I mean, it's just monster amount of guidelines. So we have to do something about that. Obviously, for decisions in medicine, immediate life-threatening issues or very technical work like surgery or dispensing, et cetera, we absolutely need guidelines, and I suggest we even need policies that exactly state you do it this way, you count this, you do all that. Then we have guidelines around potentially symptoms where I don't know if we really need guidelines to say you should use this first or this next. What you really want for guidelines is, in my opinion for that, is that to acknowledge that each person is an experiment, and a guideline I think should provide, here's what we know, here's what we have the potential of the work, here's how effective we think it is to help inform. And it doesn't necessarily have to be you do this first or this first. It can sometimes, and sometimes that's useful, but for symptom treatment, I think it's a different approach. And then when it comes to risk factor intervention, which is what I'm talking about with chronic disease state guidelines, I'm not sure if we need real specific guidelines telling us exactly what to do. At least not the way the the clinical practice guidelines are designed right now. When I talk about guidelines, I often get this feedback about why are you talking about guidelines? What possibly could be wrong with guidelines?
What the f*** is your problem?
Well, the problem is we have to look at how they're developed, what's in them, and so on. I would have absolutely no problem with guidelines if they were developed primarily by and definitely for the people that ultimately end up using them. That would be a good idea. If they were a credible synopsis of the best available evidence obtained by a systematic review and presented in a way that clinicians could easily access and interpret. And if they allowed patient values and preferences to be taken into account. That would be an ideal guideline in my view. The problem is when people look at the quality of guidelines and their reliability and so on, and I'm not saying that these guys have the definitive answer, but these guys looked at it and they have suggested that about 50% of guidelines can be considered untrustworthy. Even if it was 40% or 30% or 20%, that is way too high a number for clinical practice guidelines for people to be using in clinical practice. A number of other people have looked at this, and this is just a recent article that suggests that we need to enforce a rigorous universal methodology for creating guidelines. And they said three decades later from when we started creating many, many clinical practice guidelines, we still haven't figured out how to reliably produce high-quality guidelines. And there are two core issues that these guys suggest that we have a problem with, is there's a lack of a centralized authority to coordinate and vet and approve all of these things. So it's pretty much the wild, wild west. And there's really an absence of a universal methodology to create guidelines. And I'm going to show you some of the problems associated with that, and also hopefully give you some feedback as to how these could be improved. Some people have gone as far as suggesting that professional societies should abstain from authorship of guidelines and disease definition statements, and I don't think that's the solution to the problem. I think what we need to do, it is possible for many different groups to create solid, properly done guidelines if they follow the right approach. And then also other people have complained that the whole concept of the pirate thing about are guidelines really telling you what you must do, or is it just sort of some guidance and thought process? And again, just recently, a number of people have sort of really looked at this, and Gordon Guyatt is a big pusher behind the whole concept of evidence, properly done evidence-based guidelines. And I'm going to show you some of the examples of what they put together, and I agree with most of what they're doing, and there's one part that I'll talk that I don't tremendously agree with, but they say that all clinical practice guideline recommendations, whether the availability of evidence is considered as being of high quality or very low quality, require both that sort of concept. They need a judicious consideration of the relevant evidence from a panel regarding the interpretation of the evidence, so someone obviously has to look at the evidence and put some consideration to it, and obviously, in any guideline, every treatment that we have has the potential for harm, so there's always a benefit versus the harm and the burden associated with it. So we have to consider all of those things. And then at the bottom, they said that guideline panels are challenged with evaluating the evidence regarding patients' values and preferences. And they make a suggestion, and the reason I put it in smaller print is I don't necessarily agree with it, is that they feel that a guideline committee must come up with what do they think the majority would choose. And that's where I think it gets tricky, and I'll explain why that as we go along. So let's sort of talk about how do we actually appraise clinical practice guidelines, because even that is a science that is not well-defined at all. The most comprehensively validated appraisal tool is the Agreed To instrument, and I'm just going to spend a little bit of time telling you what that's about. It really is an instrument that looks at a variety of domains, scope and purpose, stakeholder involvement, rigor of development, clarity of presentation, applicability, editorial independence, guideline assessment. And those are the things that this group looks at. Unfortunately, there are a number of things that are missing in the assessment of what you would want in a guideline. But let's use that tool for a second, and they have actually gone and looked at how well the guidelines deal with all of the issues that they put into that sort of tool. And so they looked at 421 clinical practice guidelines for the management of common non-communicable disease in primary care. And I've listed them there: heart disease, lung disease, diabetes, dementia, etc. And they were able to rate what they said were high quality is about 24%, which I think if we told patients that or healthcare people who interact with the healthcare system that only 24% of them are regarded as high quality, that people would be somewhat concerned. The lowest median domain scores were for applicability and the rigor of development. So the rigor of development got a score from them of less than 33%, which no one expects it to be 90 or 100%, but it feels quite low, relatively speaking, if you're using the AGREE tool for that. Now, other people have come up with how can we, with sort of tools or approaches to how we should actually look at clinical practice guidelines. The Institute of Medicine, which is now has changed their name to what I think is called the National Academic Sciences and Engineering Medicine Health and Medicine Division, and they've said that the AGREE tool inadequately reflects the full range of quality clinical practice guidelines. And that's where I would definitely agree with them, is in regards to the quality of the evidence and the strength of the recommendation, which is a really important concept to be able to wrap your head around. They don't really talk much about it. It's all about more process than actually the strength and quality of the evidence and recommendations. So they suggest having other standards, establishing transparency and dealing with conflict of interest, and so on. And these are subtly different, but I'm unaware of anyone who's applied those to a whole bunch of clinical practice guidelines. So this is just another group that says these are the things that we should consider in clinical practice guidelines. And then the final one, again, that's being put together by Gordon Guyatt and that group, is a thing called GRADE, which is the Grading of Recommendations, Assessment, Development, and Evaluation. And they do focus very strongly, and appropriately so, I think, on the quality of the evidence that they talk about. And they have criteria for whether they call it high, moderate, low, and they say it depends on how confident are they in that true effect and how closely does it lie to what the estimate of that effect. So it's not so much do they follow all these criteria, it's how much does the panel, or how confident are they that the true effect lies close to that of the estimate that we have by doing a proper systematic review. So it's a much different look at clinical practice guidelines. And then they create a number of recommendations for or against whatever it is that they've looked at. So again, that's a useful thing because they have to make some decisions from the perspective of putting a clinical practice guideline. And what they say is a strong recommendation is one for which the guideline panel is confident the desirable effects of an intervention outweigh the undesirable effects, which is a legitimate way to do it. But what I want to do is show you where the problem comes in with when they try to do that. So this is what they say, this is where they try and take into account patient values and preferences. And they say a strong recommendation is when most individuals in this situation would want the recommended course of action and only a small proportion would not. And then a weak recommendation is the majority of individuals in this situation would want the suggested course of action, but many would not. That is fatally flawed because they've used words. And let me show you why that is. Here are some definitions of those words in there. Most means more than half, 51 to 99%. And you can see most is right there in a strong recommendation. The majority means more than half, which is a weak recommendation. Many is a large but indefinite number, but also the majority. So that's tricky because you've now got the majority here and the majority there. So I don't know how the guideline committees deal with that issue. All I can tell you, it's kind of made up. That's the problem with trying to put into place patients' values and preferences without a patient there in front of you. And that's a problem. And then most is more than many. So the definition is next to useless when you actually look at it. And I'm sure the conversations have gone on, but no one, I think, can really come up with appropriate values and preferences using terms like this. And then the other thing, which I think is they do a good job of, is looking at the quality of the evidence and the strength of the recommendation. They've come up with useful symbols and guidelines to do that. So I really like the approach that they're taking. I fundamentally disagree with their concept of dealing with the values and preferences. And I spoke with Gordon at a conference about a year and a half ago about that. And I said, you know, I love what you're doing, but this is a fundamental flaw. And he says, sort of paraphrase, he says, yeah, but we had to do something. And I said, why? And there was no great answer other than it's expected of us to do it. And that concerns me sometimes. Now, this is just an example of how well they present evidence. And I don't expect you to be able to look at it or even necessarily see it, but they do a really good job of putting numbers and of all of the important endpoints and presenting it in a way that's very easy for clinicians. You've got to spend some time at it, obviously, get and look at it, that, to get that information. So it's really a good systematic review. They've done a good job of looking at the evidence. They've got a good job of showing the evidence. It's just that the recommendations that are a little bit iffy. So let's just look at the evidence behind clinical practice guideline recommendations. And by that, I mean the specific type of evidence that's used. So a number of people have looked at, when a guideline makes a recommendation, what is the fundamental type of evidence that is being used to make that recommendation? So this has been looked at for cardiology, infectious disease, and endocrinology. And if you're looking at RCT evidence or higher levels of evidence, we're looking at around, in cardiology, infectious disease, and endocrinology, roughly 5 to 15% of them are based on RCT evidence. Now, not every question, not every recommendation can be answered with an RCT or should be answered with an RCT, but that's where we're talking about it when we're looking at relatively the highest level of evidence. About a third to a half of recommendations are based on opinion. So that should be made explicitly clear, because if it's an opinion, an individual healthcare provider and patients can have opinions as well. And so it's really tricky to have to deal with this. And a number of other groups have just recently looked at the same thing, where they looked at the level of evidence supporting the American College of Cardiology, American Heart Association, and the European Society of Cardiology guidelines. And they found basically the same thing when they looked at the 6,300 recommendations that they were in these guidelines. Some are, again, 10 to 15% were based on multiple RCTs or a single large RCT. About a third to 50% were observational single randomized controlled trials. And again, about 40 to 50 so percent were based on expert opinion. So a very consistent finding. And they looked at prior versions of guidelines and current guidelines, and it really hasn't fundamentally changed a lot over time. Now, there's two reasons. One, it could be the evidence base, which is certainly a possibility, and it may be that we just can't always answer these questions with the highest level of evidence. And another group has also looked at a systematic review of guidelines around primary cardiovascular disease and looked to see, do they have information, or do they discuss benefits and harms? Because that's the whole concept, is that to make a decision around in healthcare, you have to discuss the benefits and harms. So they looked at 47 guidelines, and they looked at, do they talk about the benefits and harms of doing things? And in this case, they looked at the benefits and harms around just doing cardiovascular assessment and harms and the risks associated with cardiovascular disease. Only 19% of them discussed the benefits of doing that sort of approach, and about 17% discussed the harms. So I can kind of appreciate that a little bit about the assessment and so on, that you may not have that great a discussion about the benefits and harms. But when it comes to medications, I think this is, a fundamental flaw with most guidelines. About a third even mention benefits of medications, which is, how as a clinician can you have a discussion if you don't know the benefits? And it gets even worse when we're talking about harms, where only 15 to about 20% actually mention or discuss harms. I literally do not understand why this is not 100%. It really should be 100%. Or you could say, we don't know anything about the harms, but at least we've said that. And then so this is not just, you know, a drug company trying to prevent anything, or these horrible people trying to push medications on everyone. When they talk about lifestyle, it's even worse. They don't talk about anything, or they, about 15% of the time do they discuss the benefits of lifestyle, and they never mention anything about harms, which is interesting. And in this entire case where these are conditions for which we should constantly reassess and often think about maybe stopping medications, not a single one of them mentioned anything about deprescribing. And in fact, that's a change in guidelines. Guidelines, hypertension guidelines years and years ago always had a section on, here's when you should be considered stopping. That is completely gone out of any guideline that I've ever seen when it comes to cardiovascular disease. So who writes or sponsors guidelines? What I want to do is just go over an approach of who does that. So my colleagues that I work with in the peer group in Edmonton looked at this a little while ago, and they looked at 176 primary care guidelines in the CMA database, and they looked who contributed to it. So these are guidelines, and almost all guidelines are written for primary care. There's obviously a few that aren't, but they're primarily for primary care. 54% of the contributors were non-family physician specialists. 17% were family physicians. 8% of it was industry-sponsored. 11% were other clinicians, 8% non-clinician scientists, 6% were nurses, 3% were, and 3% were pharmacists. So you can see that the overall description of people who are doing it, it's not being written primarily by the people who are primarily going to be using them. And 69% of the guidelines didn't report conflicts of interest when they looked at it in 2015. Other groups have looked at this. This was a little bit earlier, where guideline sponsorship, it's primarily being done by medical specialty societies. Government agencies do about a quarter of them, other professional associations. And at this time, only 4%, what we called independent expert panels, did that. And they suggested that at least 2/3 are being developed by groups with a clear potential for important biases. Now, that's not to suggest that these groups should not be doing them. I have never met a group that has no important biases. I literally have not. I have important biases. So I think we have to be very careful that just because we're saying they have important biases doesn't mean that invalidates their ability to be able to do a good job. Other people have looked at this and said, you know, 50 to 80% of panel members on guidelines have financial conflicts of interest. And some people, as I sort of mentioned, have gone as far as saying that is why we can't trust clinical guidelines. And I don't think that's true really at all. Does it play a little bit of a part in it? Maybe. It's really the fundamental thought process about how you do a guideline and how you put it together, in my opinion. So I want to talk a little bit about clinical chronic disease state guidelines, and by that I mean ones where they're usually going target shooting, where they're trying to get to a particular target in a particular patient, because that's a lot of the guidelines that we see on a regular basis, especially in primary care. So you will see lots of recommendations for getting to diabetics to certain numbers, blood pressures and cholesterols and all that sort of stuff. And what I'm going to suggest to you, and based on looking at this for years and years and years and trying to figure out where all of these thresholds come from, I've figured out they're pretty much arbitrary. I've sat on some of these guidelines, and the debate often is whoever speaks the loudest gets the threshold they want. And the reason is there is usually very little good evidence to guide what threshold we should be doing. So it has to be based on opinion, marginally informed by some evidence. So I am not a big fan of that part of guidelines saying this is when you should treat. And just here's just an example. These are the different target levels for hemoglobin A1C with guidelines written around the same time. Different people come up with different things, 7 to 8, less than 7, less than 6.5. So why is it that? If it was so obvious, we should all be finding very similar numbers. But it's because the decision about thresholds very rarely hangs on solid evidence. So it's going to be almost completely opinion-based. It doesn't mean I don't know which one of these is right. I don't even know if any of them are right. That's the tricky part. And there was just some recent, I always love the guidelines where they're trying to make it like we're all fighting each other. And sometimes we are. But I like this. Major medical associations feud over diabetes guidelines. So the guidelines coming out from the American College of Physicians said clinicians should aim to achieve an A1C between 7 and 8% in most patients. And their thought process these are guidelines written primarily by internists, and they dealt with the issue of the harm associated with aggressive lowering of blood glucose. Now, if you put endocrinologists into a room, just like if you put hypertension experts or lipid experts, they will want it as low as possible. almost without exception. And so these guys came up with, we think an A1C level of less than 6.5 is considered optimal. And in Canada, the Canadian guidelines, published about a year and a half ago, say most people should get less than 7. Canadians are so vague. I love the Canadian, you know, it's like why did the Canadian chicken cross the road? To get to the middle. So most said it should be less than 7%, but if you can get them to 6.5, if they're at low risk for hypoglycemia, you should do that. And if you look at all of many guidelines about target A1Cs, they vary a lot. And I've always said when I talk to people about guidelines, why don't you tell me what you want to do, and I'll find you a guideline that will support you. And that applies to pneumonia. If you want to use this antibiotic for pneumonia, I'm pretty much sure I could find a guideline that supports you. So the next step is, we've looked at the evidence, how do they deal with stuff associated with values and preferences? Because it is all about the people who take the medications. We dole out lots of treatments, and that's pills, but we do other things as well for certain types of treatments. But it's the patient who ends up ingesting them, if you will, or having to deal with it. So a number of years ago, probably about 12 years ago, Peter Lowen, a friend and colleague of mine at the faculty, we looked at how much do they talk about value in clinical practice guidelines. So this is a little dated, but this is what we found. We looked at the 5 Canadian guidelines for blood pressure, cholesterol, glucose, and bone density, which in my opinion, every one of those decisions is purely based on values and preferences based on benefits and harm discussion. When you add them all together, there were 197 pages, 90,000 words. 99 words were relevant to patients' values and preferences, 0.1% of the words. And we struggled to find those words. Like, we were very generous. So there was virtually no discussion of values and preferences at that time. We tried to let people know about it. I sent our paper to all of the guideline people, and most of them never responded. And recently, or it was about four years ago, a guideline came out, a diabetes guideline came out, and as I was reading it, it says, management of hypoglycemia in type 2 diabetes in 2015, a patient-centered approach. And I thought, brilliant, we're going to make some headway in this. Let me show you what happened. It's 113 pages. We also need a page limit in guidelines. Anything more than I'm thinking 20 is ridiculous. We can communicate better than that. But anyway, this is 113 pages. So we went through it looking for info on, is there anything about risk estimation and magnitude of what the problem is? We looked at the impact of, is there any information about the impact of treatment on the risk associated with A1C? We looked at for the potential harms and the magnitude, and we found precious little. So when that happens, I write letters, and we did that. And we said, the information presented in these documents is glucose-centric and not organized or presented in a way that could be considered as supporting shared decision-making. So when you write a letter, people respond, and they actually were quite nice in the response, and I'll show you what that was. This is their response. Would like to thank McCormack et al. For their thoughtful letter regarding the American Diabetes Association standards of medical care and diabetes, which is always nice. They always say thank you. And then they usually say something nasty, but in this case, they didn't. They agree that shared decision-making is a valuable aspect of diabetes care. The process would be incredibly labor-intensive and would make the standards long and unwieldy. Did you remember the page limit that they had on that? That is such a cop-out. And then I'm just going to show you their last, I think it was the last line that they said. They said this, and I want to know if you can figure out what is wrong with this statement. So that's either they completely screwed it up, or they believe it, which gives you the underlying flaw in how they develop guidelines. So recently we've looked at some hypertension guidelines, the 2016 Canadian hypertension guidelines, 11,800 words, 20 pages. So not too long, which is good. Total mention of values and preferences, 0.19%, or close to 100% increase in what we found earlier. I like this. This is the words they use. Practitioners are advised to consider patient preferences, values, and clinical factors when determining how to best apply these recommendations at the bedside, which is great. That's what we should be doing. But then they said something like this: in the absence of Canadian data, avoid using absolute levels of risk to support treatment decisions. So you literally can't do it because they're saying you can't. No. We want you to do it, but don't use numbers that would make any sense at all, or put it into the proper context. Recently, the osteoporosis guidelines out of the States, 8,700 words, 2,700 pages. No numbers whatsoever for fracture risk or fracture benefit. They do present info in an appendix, which is sometimes useful. The guidelines are now getting to the point they're so long that they create an appendix of the new studies that have come out. And they often do a marginally good job of presenting those numbers. Now, they did talk about harms, which is good. They gave some 28 numeric mentions of side effects, which is an improvement over what we saw earlier. But most of it was in relative numbers, and it was difficult to put that into a context. They did make one mention of patient preferences. And I don't know if you can read that. It says they recommend that clinicians should make the decision whether to treat osteopenic women 65 years of age or older. That's how they dealt with patient preferences. Yeah, you get patient preferences, but the clinician must make the decision. Again, an interesting twist on the concept of shared decision making. And then just recently, the Canadian Diabetes Guidelines, 325 pages. So we went through this again. This is painful work, but it's fun. The risk of diabetes complications, you couldn't make a ballpark assessment of cardiovascular. You couldn't get information out of it and say, if you have diabetes, this would be your risk of cardiovascular disease, or renal disease, or blindness, or amputation, or anything. They do talk a little bit about benefits of treatment, which is, again, an improvement, but mostly described as relative benefits. And they do have a few tables on harms, but they're just sort of just one-word items with no magnitude or anything associated with it. And one of their quotes was, where available, NNT or NNH was considered in assessing the impact of a particular intervention. So they're fundamentally looking to try to find that. They did it once. And it was a Steno trial, which is a trial that has shown the greatest benefit ever in aggressive diabetes control overall. Almost all the recommendations could have had that information in there, but they just literally mentioned it once. And let me remind you, in the 325 pages. Now, they did a better job a little bit of mentioning some of the newer clinical trials. So these are some of the words and the presentation that they did in it. You know, the DPP-4 trials show no benefit, but of course that doesn't matter because they still said there is a place for it. Insulin, no benefit, but they still said that there is a place for it and so on. And they do give absolute numbers of some of the studies around the glufosinate medications and so on. So it is better, but I can tell you it took a long time to find those numbers. It's not a simple thing that you can go find. So those are the guidelines. Those are the things around values and preferences, the evidence. Now what I want to just briefly run by is values and preferences are really important because I think there's pretty good evidence that expectations of patients are different than what we think about them. So this has been looked at, and not everybody wants to do shared decision making, and not every decision, I don't think, lends well to shared decision making, but a huge, relatively speaking, the majority I think do, and we'll go from there. And these guys suggest that the number of patients who prefer participation has increased over the past few decades, so that the majority of patients prefer to participate in decisions to some degree or not. And people have asked, they show people guidelines and say, this is when we would treat. What do you think? Would you take it if you were a patient? Would you take it? And interestingly, when they ask patients and clinicians, many of the preferences expressed by clinicians and lay people in the study are at odds with recommendations and guidelines. So not only do the patients not want it, the clinicians who are following the guidelines would not follow the guidelines. And I hear this all the time. I talk to clinicians. Well, would you do that, what it says in the guideline? Oh, no, no. Well, why not? Well, because there's medications. I don't like taking medications. Some would. And that's the issue, is you cannot look at a person and go, yeah, you, for 1%, I know you would take it, and you don't care about harm, but you do care about cost. You can't do that without having that conversation. And for preventative treatments and for things to do with fracture prevention, 77% of doctors would recommend the treatment, but 21% of their patient cohort would consider treatment justified. So we're not talking on the same song sheet when we're talking about who would or who would not want to take that. And I'm trying to create a case where maybe we should stop doing that. Part of the problem is how we write in general. And this is not unique to the press. It's not unique to how we write at a university. We use terms like this, and we use these terms all the time when we're speaking. And I have used all of these terms probably as I've been speaking to you. We use these terms, and every one of those means something different to everybody else. Yet guidelines and research papers, they use these words all the time. They are great at conveying a story, but they don't really convey the evidence and numbers in it. I think we fundamentally have to stop using terms like this because it doesn't answer the question. And I was asked to give a talk to a group of reporters and people who are writing in the press, and I said, please stop doing this. You're not helping it out. And they say, yeah, but it's what everybody does. And I agree. If you were to look at the guidelines that people write, and even the guidelines I'm going to show you that I've been participating in, we do use those words, but we need to back off as much as we can and use numbers. Because I'll just give you an example. These are things that you would want quantified if you read it in a guideline or someone told you about this. Your salary will be increased. You would want to touch more information about that. Turn left after a moderate number of kilometers. That is not good guidance. But we do it all the time in our clinical practice guidelines and how we speak in medicine. You'll be getting a short jail sentence. There's short and then there's short. You have an unlikely chance of getting an STD. That's not good enough for me. I need to know a little bit more than that. You have a significant chance of a heart attack. We use that term in healthcare all the time. We say high risk. It's meaningless. I know we've studied this. We studied this 30 years ago where we asked patients, "What if we said high risk, what does it mean?" And when they say, what does it mean? Their average thought of high risk is 50 to 60% chance in the next 5 years of getting a heart attack. There is nobody in the world that is at that high a risk. You could be a smoker, have nothing but cholesterol in your blood. In your blood, you could have blood pressure so high that blood is spurting out your head. You're still not at a 50 to 60% chance of a heart attack in 5 years. It just doesn't get there. And then the final one, I don't know if this would make me a bit nervous. A small tube will be placed a considerable distance into your rectum. I would want to know a little bit clearer definition of what you're talking about. And this is a tricky thing for many, many people. I'm trying to think how long ago it was, and some of you guys will recognize some of the people in this paper. Legitimately, this was a group that was complaining, if you will, or had concerns about how guidelines about antidepressants are talking about the problem with withdrawal. The NICE guidelines state just simply, I think it was just one or two lines, they state withdrawal symptoms are usually mild and self-limiting over about 1 week. And that's just, there is some truth to it, but it's too vague, and these authors were suggesting it should be more specific. And I was asked to review the letter prior to it being published, and that group we all have agendas, they clearly had an agenda to say that the medications, that antidepressants are relatively very poorly tolerated and lots of withdrawal and all of that. And they use many of the magnitudinous problem words that I just showed you. And I went through it all. And to their credit, I said, why not just give the numbers? And they actually ended up doing that, which is really cool because the initial letter only contained just a couple of numbers. And then they went off on using these magnitudinous words that didn't really help. And so it was good because they listened and they put in numbers that, as best we could get, tell you about the problem. So it's not difficult to do that. I was able to get those numbers. They were able to get them. I was able to get them in about an hour and a half of searching. So it's not that difficult to do the right thing when it comes to presenting evidence. I'll just give you an example. 325 pages, diabetes guidelines, one page, one table, every study that's ever looked at important clinical outcomes in type 2 diabetes. Every study, every outcome, every drug. That took me about two evenings to put together. So it can be done. I'm not suggesting you can even read this, but it would be a useful thing. You could read it if it was in front of you. But it tells you, this is the drug that was studied. Did it improve outcomes? Did it not improve outcomes? Were they neutral? And if they did improve or cause harm, those are the outcomes that it was, and these are the absolute numbers. I'm not saying that this means that you should or should not use any of these drugs. I'm saying it would be really good if guidelines presented a table for clinicians to look at this type of information. And it's, like I said, it's not difficult to put together. One of the reasons that I created a thing called mystudies.org, where we have around 300 studies, is that I couldn't find a place where all of the studies, all of the major cardiovascular studies, and I don't think it's obviously not all of them, but probably I'd say 90% of the really, really important clinical trials that have been done in cardiology and diabetes and so on are on a website. It's a free website. You can go to it, and all you have to do is click on the study, and it will show you every number in all of the studies with all the absolute numbers, all the relative numbers, all the confidence intervals, everything in one little place, and it'll tell you a little bit about who was studied and so on. It's not perfect. It's not supposed to be everything about that study. Obviously, you need to look in more in depth at these studies, but it's easily accessible. So if you wanted to find out what actually happened in the very first VA trial of hypertension, just go on there. It's right there. All the numbers are there. So it's not a matter of, it's not difficult to get this, is what I'm saying. Where it does get difficult is how people understand statistics. This is a big issue when it comes to not just people who don't look at statistics in healthcare, but even people who look at statistics in healthcare. So recently we looked at, there's been a big debate, do statins reduce mortality in primary prevention? So the only way you can really answer that is to look at meta-analyses of studies that have looked at that question. What is fascinating is that at the time we wrote that paper is, do statins reduce mortality in primary prevention? There were five meta-analyses. Three said, yes, they do. And two said, no, they don't. And you go, well, this is what drives everybody nuts, because these were just one after another. Yes, it does. Oh, no, they don't. Yes, they do. No, they don't. And we see this all the time with everything around nutrition. Well, it causes cancer, then it doesn't cause cancer. Actually, it reduces cancer. This is why the public thinks we are marginally insane, because we cannot get it right. And one of the reasons is people don't know how to look at simple statistics. So what I want to do, what we did is we showed, it's because people don't understand confidence intervals. So this is the actual data from each one of those meta-analyses. And this is the point estimate for each one of these. So they all have the access to the same pool of studies, but they obviously had different selection criteria. So that some of them had, 9 studies and, 11 studies and so on. And these are the point estimates and confidence intervals. They are not perfectly overlapping with each other, but you can see that this one was a yes. Why? Because it just didn't happen to include that arbitrary threshold of 1. This one just skipped over that one, so they said, no, it doesn't. This one, yes, it does. Yes, it does. No, it doesn't, because it just hinged on that. I have no idea if they reduce mortality. If I was a betting person and I had to bet, does it increase mortality? I would bet that it doesn't. Do I think it has a positive effect on mortality? If I was asked to say, does it have no effect or is it positive, I would lean on the positive, because these results are fairly consistent. The problem is the headlines and the abstracts and the people who write these articles don't understand confidence intervals. Confidence intervals are not yes and no. That is a really important distinction, and we try and get our students to understand that, and I think they are. Okay, so one of the biggest questions when I talk about guidelines, the biggest comment that comes back to me is, but what? I'm afraid of getting sued. And it's a consistent question. And I almost, whenever anyone asks me, when I give these talks, and put the first person, especially when it's for a bunch of clinicians, when the first person put up, I said, you're going to ask me about getting sued, aren't you? And I'm almost always right, because that's the concern. And it's a legitimate concern. Being sued is a horrible, horrible thing. So what do we know about the legal system and guidelines? So remember I said the diabetes guidelines were 325 pages? I was able to get a useful piece of information out of them. It said this: as per the Canadian Medical Association, clinical practice guidelines should not be used as legal resource in malpractice cases. Doesn't mean they won't be, but they're just saying that it shouldn't be. And we've had a number of the Medical Protection Association, I think that's the right term, lawyers come to our course and talk about what is the legal thing around guidelines. And this is a report that they published about 8 or 9 years ago, saying that even an authoritative clinical practice guideline may not be found to be determinant of a standard of care. Now, they didn't say it wouldn't be. So that's written by lawyers. So They said what you should consult with a colleague or relevant specialist, discuss reasonable treatment options with a patient and so on, and physicians should consider documenting the rationale and so on. That's how you sort of prevent, in theory, being sued. You can never get rid of the risk 100%. Where I think things are fundamentally changing in the courts are as follows. This is some recent stuff out of a number of courts in a number of countries that are suggesting that the reasonable patient standard is that it requires physicians and other healthcare practitioners to disclose all relevant information about the risk, benefits, and alternatives that an objective patient would find material. That is going to vary between patients. They have different opinions of different things, but this is the standard that we are going to be being pushed towards. I could only find one article that was thoroughly talked about this and gave advice and so on, and it was an article from about 2015 where what they did is they said, what is the approach that we should be doing if we are trying to reduce the risk of being sued for what we do? And this is the flow chart. It's a bit confusing, I admit, but I'm going to simplify it in just a second. So there's two things that we could do. We could either do a shared decision-making process or defensive medicine. Defensive medicine is following the guidelines. Obviously, you can't get sued if an adverse outcome doesn't occur. So what's nice is the vast majority of people don't have adverse outcomes, so you're not going to get sued for it. But if you do get sued, if an adverse outcome does occur, if you were to follow through, what is the best way of being at a low risk of end up being sued? This is what they suggest, because that's where we want to get. We want to go to get low risk. We cannot get people to no risk. That's just not going to happen. So they suggest, and again, there's no randomized controlled trials or cohorts of this, but they said with a defensive model, following guidelines of standard of care, you never get to a low litigation risk. They said you can only get to about a low to medium. And you know I'm not a big fan of low medium terms, but there is no other way to really describe that. They said these are the two things you need to do to reduce litigation risk to a low risk. Use a shared decision-making model, use a decision aid, and document that decision. So that's the best that we have for what you should be doing from a legal perspective. You realize it doesn't ever go to no risk. So what's the guideline solution? I'm just going to take about two or three more months, I think, I'd get there. So as I said before, guidelines would be awesome if they were developed primarily by indefinite for the people who would use them, if they were a credible synopsis of the best available evidence and allow patient values and preferences to be put into case. I think guidelines should clearly provide ballpark estimates of what happened if you don't treat, test, or screen, or if you do treat, test, or screen. And this is from a colleague, friend of mine, who I think really tries to do all of this stuff on a day-to-day basis. And I like this. I would rather know evidence and try to apply it to each patient than memorize guidelines and try to apply them to all patients. That is a great line, in my opinion. Don't tell him I said that. And I also think guideline writers should not care about the final recommendations. You should not care about them. That is very difficult to not care, but you should go in going, I don't really care. So in the last number of years, we've published a number of guidelines because we, as a group, we were occasionally asked to sit on other guidelines, and it just became it was just painfully awful because it was one person or two people, and you couldn't do anything. So a lot of people said, well, if you're going to complain about guidelines, why don't you write them? And we said, okay. And so we've done three so far, and we've got another couple coming down the pipeline. We did the simplified lipid guidelines, simplified guidelines for medical cannabinoids and opioid use disorder. And this is the process we think. They were all informed by questions identified by primary care clinicians. They were all informed by a systematic review. All benefits and harms were presented as absolute numbers in calculators and or evidence tables. All promoted shared decision as an integral part of the guideline. All provided patient material. That was some of the focuses that I am not suggesting that our guidelines are perfect. They are far from perfect. But the approach that we took, I think, is a better approach to putting together guidelines. And this is just an example of what we did. But a key feature is this is for dealing with lipids and so on. We had thresholds for discussion, not thresholds for treatment. A fundamentally different thought process about what to do. And then we did patient information that we put together, and we said, are statins right for you? Regardless of your decision, your healthcare provider will support you. We think they should support you, or hopefully they do, but they said it's your decision. And then we created calculators, the best ones we could find, and presented evidence in a way that evidence is supposed to be presented based on the best available evidence of how you present evidence. Again, these are not perfect, but they're at least put together to help with that. And what was nice is that the group wrote about our guidelines in the BMJ saying they liked it for its simplicity and that it offers lifestyle and drug options without judging which is best for an individual, and we linked to attractive risk calculators that can be used. We're not the only people doing it. I think ACP is doing a pretty good job of presenting evidence, and I don't know if you can see, but this is, if you look at this, you can't see this table, you're not supposed to, but this is an evidence table that if you look at it, it gives you the numbers in an easy way to understand. The BMJ is also doing that with the Gordon Guyatt group and the grade group, and they do a beautiful job of presenting the numbers in a way that you can look at the benefits and harms. As I said before, I'm not a big fan of how they decide to give recommendations, but that's the case. So let's recap. There are lots of guidelines. They often don't provide a solid synopsis or a systematic review of the best available evidence. They often don't provide sufficient information to do shared decision making or even support the concept. Many conflicts and ownership issues. Patient expectations are often at odds with guideline recommendations. And legal precedents are leaning in favor of benefit harm communication. And useful guidelines can be written. And I'm sure some of you are reading this going, how dare you use words that you just complained about? And I've highlighted those for you. And I highlighted them to say, if you go back into my talk, you can get the numbers associated with the words that I'm using for that most of the time. But remember, most, I don't even know what that means. So I'm a bit long. I could show you a clip of a two-minute clip of a video that I've done, and then we can go ask questions or do, yeah. So this is just a fun music video that we put together to talk about the issue of guidelines.
Now for something completely different.
Look, you've got it all wrong. You don't need to follow me. You don't need to follow anybody. You've got to think for yourself. You're all individuals.
Yes, we're all individuals.
You're all different.
Yes, we are all different.
I'm not.
I'll just play about a minute of this then.
That's just the song they sing.
The end of that line.
It's all about your risk of getting serious things.
The end of that line.
But don't sit around and worry what tomorrow will bring.
The end of that line.
Knowledge is king.
So I truly do believe knowledge is king, but we have to present it in the best way. And by when I say king, I also mean queen and prince and everybody. But knowledge is the way to go about doing this, and we have to be able to present it properly, and I'd be happy to answer any questions or hear comments from you. Thank you for listening.